Be sure to follow my ministry on BitChute and Rumble, because this channel could disappear any day. Also, if you haven't already, subscribe to my YouTube backup channel. Links are in the description box and in my pinned comment below. I am asking that if you can, to please help to financially support this ministry. If you feel led to pledge any amount of money, it would be extremely helpful and greatly appreciated. There is a PayPal link in the description box and in my pinned comment below. You can also donate using Cash App. My cash tag is $Watchman1963. Thank you all so much for your prayers and support. God bless. Welcome to the Watchman channel. This channel is all about world news and Bible prophecy, pointing to the soon return of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Rapper Lil Nas X's Nike Satan shoes spark outrage. Yes, they contain one drop of human blood. The shoes will reportedly contain 66 cc's of red ink and one drop of human blood in its sole. Other features of the infernal footwear are a pentagram pendant over the laces and Luke 10:18 written on the side, which reads, "And he said to them, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." The sneakers coincide with Lil Nas X's latest song and music video called Montero, Call Me By Your Name. "I saw something I didn't quite believe I ever would see. An openly gay music superstar indulging in a sex and sin video fantasy with Satan." Be advised, this video is evil, blasphemous, and debased.
Lil Nas X is taking Dancing with the Devil to a whole other level. The 21-year-old rapper dropped the music video for his new single, Montero, Call Me By Your Name. The video, which Lil Nas co-directed, is filled with many biblical and ancient Greek references, including a seductive half-snake, half-human in the Garden of Eden. A shackled-up Lil Nas then finds himself at execution day in a coliseum where he is surrounded and receives judgment from versions of himself. And once he's executed, he goes down the pole to hell to seduce the devil himself. Lil Nas also opened up about the significance of his latest song by sharing an emotional letter he wrote his younger self about coming out as gay. He started out writing, "Dear 14-year-old Montero," which is his birth name. "I know we promised to never come out publicly. I know we promised to never be that type of gay person. I know we promised to die with the secret, but this will open doors for many other queer people to simply exist." In Lil Nas's opening voiceover in the music video, he also shares that he's done hiding his true, authentic self.
"You know, the fame and fortune, like mentally, spiritually, I've grown so much."
The new song has already received lots of love from Lil Nas X fans and his celebrity pals like Miley Cyrus, who posted herself listening to the bop and sent Lil Nas flowers to celebrate. And even more touching, the Georgia native also got the stamp of approval from his dad, sharing a screenshot of a text message that says, "Live life on your terms. Very proud of you."
John 8:44. "You are of your father the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it." During the end times, the Bible says that wickedness and evil will run rampant all over the world. To be a Christian today is to rebel against these vices and to speak out against the holy weird experience that is beginning to invade almost every aspect of our lives and society. In fact, the Bible said that these things would occur in the end times, and that even Jesus warned that by resisting these things that Christians would be hated by all nations. Jesus said, "The world hated him first," so that we should expect that the world will hate us as well. Satan isn't masking his intentions anymore, is he? Battle lines are being drawn, and people are choosing sides. If you know someone who doesn't know the Lord, tell them. Time is definitely running out for them to come to Jesus. Revelation 12:12. "Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you, having great wrath, because he knows that he has a short time." A good indicator we are living in the last moments of human history is that Satan has infiltrated our society in every way possible. We must understand Satan hates us because we are created in the image of Almighty God. Satan wants not only to be like God, but wants to exalt himself above God, as we read in 2 Thessalonians 2:4. Who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worshipped, so that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. Satan has worked his way onto the TV screen, where he is portrayed as a fun and caring guy on the path of redemption, where women love him and men want to be him. Satan is busy deceiving mankind, and mankind is falling for his deceptions. 2 Corinthians 4:3 and 4. But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. Make no mistake about Satan. There is no redemption for him. His fate has been sealed, as we read in Revelation 20:10. The devil, who deceived them, was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever. Satan wants to take as many people to hell with him as possible. 1 Peter 5:8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. 1 John 4:4. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because he who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Pope Francis commits blasphemy by tweeting Mary is the bridge to God. Mary is not only the bridge joining us to God, she is more. She is the road that God traveled to reach us and the road that we must travel in order to reach him. The Bible is clear. Jesus is the only mediator between God and men, as we read in 1 Timothy 2:5. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. Matthew 24:11. Then many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. False prophet is the Greek word pseudoprophetes, which means a pretended foreteller or religious imposter. A false prophet is a person who spreads false teachings or messages while claiming to speak the word of God. Rather than speak the word of the Lord, false prophets deliver messages that originate in their own hearts, as we read in Jeremiah 23:16. Thus says the Lord of hosts, do not listen to the words of the prophets who prophesy to you. They make you worthless. They speak a vision of their own heart, not from the mouth of the Lord. In the Old Testament, punishment for false prophets was severe, as we read in Deuteronomy 18:20. But the prophet who presumes to speak a word in my name, which I have not commanded him to speak, or who speaks in the name of other gods, that prophet shall die. In the New Testament, Jesus warns his followers about false prophets, as we read in Matthew 7:15 through 20. Beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Do men gather grapes from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? Even so, every good tree bears good fruit, but a bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot bear bad fruit, nor can a bad tree bear good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Therefore, by their fruits you will know them. Jesus then gives a dire warning to false prophets, as we read in Matthew 7:21 through 23. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. Scripture teaches believers to be diligent in faith and devotion to Christ's teachings, so that they will be able to spot false prophets and false teachers quickly. 1 Timothy 4:1. Now the Spirit expressly says that in the latter time some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. 1 John 4:1. Beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, for many false prophets have gone out into the world. What does it mean to test the spirits? The reason for the admonition to test the spirits, or test all things, is that there are many false prophets, or wolves in sheep's clothing, that try to lead Christians astray. Sadly, there are many people who claim to speak for God, who are presenting a false gospel that is powerless to save. Such errant teaching leaves people with a false hope of salvation. 2 Corinthians 11:13 through 15 warns us, for such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also transform themselves into ministers of righteousness, whose end will be according to their works. The reason for testing the spirits is to see if it is truly from God, or if it is a lie from Satan and his servants. The test is to compare what is being taught with the clear teaching of the Bible. The Bible alone is the Word of God. It alone is inspired and inerrant. Therefore, the way to test the spirits is to see if what is being taught is in line with the clear teaching of Scripture. In Acts 17:10 and 11, the Berean Jews were commended because after they heard the teachings of Paul and Silas, they examined the Scriptures daily to see if these things were so. The Bereans were called noble for doing so. Testing the spirits means that one must know how to examine the Scriptures. Rather than accept every teaching, discerning Christians diligently study the Scriptures. Then they know what the Bible says and therefore can test all things and hold fast to what is true. In order to do this, a Christian must be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. The word of God is to be a lamp and a light to our path. We must let its light shine on the teachings and doctrines of the day. The Bible alone is the standard by which all truth must be judged. 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17. All Scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. Jesus said, as a sign of his coming and the end of the age, there would be an increase in deception, false Christs who will deceive many, wars and rumors of wars, nation against nation and kingdom against kingdom, famines, pestilences, earthquakes, Christian persecution, apostasy, false prophets, and lawlessness causing the love of many to grow cold. Jesus said all of these signs would come like birth pains. Jesus was likening last day's events to a woman in labor. As the labor progresses, the pains increase in both frequency and intensity until the baby finally comes. As we get closer to Jesus' return, all the signs he gave us as a sign of his coming and the end of the age will become more frequent and more intense. All of these signs are manifesting around the world in our time.
Near record rain in Tennessee over the weekend caused massive flooding and left at least four people dead. This is after dozens of tornadoes tore through four southern states last week. At least five people were killed by those storms, and this type of destruction has been happening more frequently in recent years. CBS News meteorologist Jeff Berardelli has more on that.
The torrential rains in Tennessee left people stranded in their cars, leading at least one Good Samaritan to come to the rescue in waist-deep floodwaters. Nashville fire crews also made at least 130 rescues.
The teams responded bravely to rescue people not only from their homes and cars, but also to make sure that they go to known areas, residents that may live outdoors.
Homes were left devastated by the downpours, with living rooms knee-deep in floodwaters. Nashville's mayor says in 48 hours, the city received more than 7 inches of rain.
Now that is the second highest two-day rainfall total in our history.
Meanwhile, we're getting a clearer look at the destruction caused by more than a dozen tornadoes that tore through four southern states late last week and over the weekend. While there's no clear estimate on the cost of the recent damage, last year broke a record, with 22 weather and climate disasters costing $1 billion or more each. Over the past 5 years, the annual cost has been trending upward to an average of more than $121 billion. The reason? Warmer oceans and atmosphere caused by human-caused climate change are providing more energy to fuel these extreme weather systems. That means individual storms, like the one we're seeing now, can also be more extreme, with even greater amounts of rain and more numerous tornadoes.
The world is baffled at the events taking place in the weather, and yet it was foretold 2,000 years ago in Bible prophecy that this would happen. Satan, the great deceiver, often tries to front-run God by giving people wrong ideas ahead of time about what is prophesied to happen. Satan has tricked mankind into believing that climate change is real, and in turn has blinded many people to the gospel of Jesus Christ, as we read in 2 Corinthians 4:3 and 4. But even if our gospel is veiled, it is veiled to those who are perishing, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe, lest the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine on them. Jesus said a sign of his return would be more frequent and more intense weather, as we read in Matthew 24:7 and 8. And there will be famines, pestilences, and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of birth pains. Pestilence is the Greek word loimus, which means a plague. Definition of a plague is any large-scale calamity, especially when thought to be sent by God. God has used plagues in the form of extreme weather in the past, and will again in the future. The seventh plague on Egypt was hail. Don't forget about the famine in Joseph's time. One of the biggest is the flood in the book of Genesis. In the future, during the seven-year tribulation, God will once again use extreme weather in the form of pestilence as judgment. In Revelation 16:21, God uses hailstones weighing 100 pounds each, and great hail from heaven fell upon men, each hailstone about the weight of a talent. Men blasphemed God because of the plague of the hail, since that plague was exceedingly great. In Revelation 16:8-9, God uses scorching heat. Then the fourth angel poured out his bowl on the sun, and power was given to him to scorch men with fire. And men were scorched with great heat, and they blasphemed the name of God who has power over these plagues, and they did not repent and give him glory. Climate change is simply Satan's counter to Jesus' signs of his return and the end of the age. So when Jesus Christ warns us that just before his second coming, there will be famines, pestilences, and earthquakes in various places, you had better believe that these occurrences are a sign from God and that he is about to intervene. Don't let Satan blind you to the gospel of Jesus Christ. The extreme weather the world has been witnessing is not climate change. It is God letting us know our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, is returning.
Severe weather ripped through the South over the weekend from Texas to the Mid-Atlantic, leaving a trail of damage in its wake.
Torrential rains across Tennessee flooded homes and churches and left roads impassable. Nashville's mayor declared a state of emergency Sunday night after more than 7 inches of rain fell on the city, the second highest two-day total in recorded history. The Nashville Fire Department had to rescue more than 130 people from cars, apartments, and houses. At least 4 people died.
It took 600 of our fire personnel to respond to these events, along with our emergency response units and water rescue.
Homes were filled with water.
It looks like someone came in and ransacked.
The storms devastated other parts of the South, with 16 tornadoes in a 24-hour period. In Shelby County, Alabama, Dave Grubick saw his home of 20 years reduced to a pile of rubble.
We were able to salvage quite a bit of memories, scrapbooks, baby books, pictures on the wall of the grandkids. I'm going to tell you what even touched me more, the people that are helping. I don't even know who they are.
And in East Texas, these aerials show some of the aftermath. Buildings heavily damaged, including this church. Trees snapped in two and debris everywhere.
And I got right in the hallway and it hit. I heard glass and my roof. I heard that aluminum coming off. And I kept praying, Lord, Lord, Lord. And where I was standing, nothing was touched.
Alabama residents are still cleaning up after twisters devastated homes and killed at least 5 people late last week.
Jesus, speaking to his disciples about the signs of his coming and the end of the age, declares this in Matthew 24:12, and because lawlessness will be increased, the love of many will grow cold. The Bible tells us lawlessness is the violation of God's commandments, as we read in 1 John 3:4. Whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness, and sin is lawlessness. Sin will be so rampant and so commonplace in the last days that the love people once had for one another, for many, will be non-existent. In this prophecy, Jesus Christ is describing an ongoing breakdown in the relationship with God. And since people's love for God is waning, it will be evident in the way people treat one another as well. A symptom may be that the love toward other people is decreasing, but the real cause is that the relationship with God is cooling off. This is what we are witnessing in our world today.
Breaking news overnight, deadly shootings in Virginia Beach, a night of violence in the city's oceanfront resort area, which is now an active crime scene. Overnight chaos in the streets of Virginia Beach. At least 8 people shot and 2 killed across multiple crime scenes.
Emergency ride. EMS is going to be sending multiple ambulances. If you can self-dispatch onto a call zone unit, please do that to help out.
Police say several people were shot at one location, with 8 people taken to local hospitals with gunshot wounds.
While officers were actively working that crime scene, we had additional shots that were fired.
According to authorities, after more shootings just blocks away, a special operations officer shot and killed a male suspect after that suspect confronted police. That officer, a 5-year veteran, is on administrative leave while the incident is investigated. WVEC reporter Allie Weatherton has details from the scene.
Dan, the Virginia Beach Police Department calls it a chaotic night. Investigators are still here combing through all of the evidence. The police chief said someone also hit a police officer with a car. That officer is expected to be okay. The Virginia Beach Police Chief said several people are currently in custody.
The Apostle Paul, in his epistle to Timothy, tells us in the last days society will be in a total immoral meltdown. 2 Timothy 3:1-5. But know this, that in the last days perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. And from such people, turn away.
Now to another mass shooting in Chicago. Our cameras were there as police found one of the guns used during that attack in Wrightwood. It left one person dead, seven others injured. And the moment shots were fired, all caught on camera.
Yeah, Brad, a lot of evidence and no arrests tonight. People tell us the place where this mass shooting happened is a problematic party spot. They also tell us the people who were there were gathered celebrating the life of a man who was also the victim of gun violence.
To that horrific story out of D.C., a carjacking that left a delivery driver there dead. But now two teenage girls, ages 15 and 13, have been charged with assaulting him with a stun gun, leading to the crash that killed him.
That deadly attack on a 66-year-old Uber Eats driver happened in broad daylight, 4:30 p.m. as he was trying to deliver food. Those two teen suspects arrested in a shocking and senseless crime.
This morning, two teenage girls arrested, charged with felony murder and armed carjacking after police say they violently attacked and killed an Uber Eats driver in Washington, D.C. Police say the suspects, just 13 and 15 years old, were in the process of trying to steal 66-year-old Mohammed Anwar's car when one of them used a taser on him as they tried to speed off, which police say led to the deadly car crash. The car flipping over, Anwar ejected. He was rushed to the hospital with life-threatening injuries but did not survive. The teens arrested at the scene. Anwar's loved ones calling the sudden loss immeasurable, telling ABC News the father of three and grandfather of four moved to the U.S. from Pakistan in 2014 to build a better life for himself and his family. Police say they've seen a spike in carjackings in Washington, D.C. and in several other major cities since the pandemic began. In 2020, 345 carjackings were reported in the nation's capital, more than double the year before.
A horrifying crime in San Dimas that we brought to you as breaking news here on KCAL 9 News at 4 yesterday. A Glendora grandmother and her dog stabbed to death at a local park. A 23-year-old suspect is now in custody. And today, as KCAL 9's Jasmine Veal shows us, a community is left shocked and saddened.
I'm in total shock. I haven't been able to sleep.
Nancy Hammond was one of many people who came by today to drop off flowers on the corner across from Lone Hill Park in San Dimas, where 66-year-old Jeannie Edgar and her dog were stabbed to death yesterday in what appears to be a random attack.
I'm just deeply saddened on how something like this could happen in this community. During broad daylight, I mean, how brazen.
Homicide detectives with the LA County Sheriff's Department arrested 23-year-old Ricardo Saldivar from Upland for her murder. They say Saldivar was armed with a knife and first went after a man who was walking to use the public restroom. Tony Page told us that man is his son-in-law, Joe, who was able to run back to his truck for safety. The suspect then turned on Edgar, who was just walking by.
Started stabbing the dog to death. Turned and started stabbing the lady to death.
Authorities say that's when Page's son-in-law grabbed a rock and hit the suspect in the head, knocking him unconscious and holding him until authorities arrived. Today, neighbors say his actions possibly saved lives at the busy park and playground.
The Dewey Pest Control guy wound up. Was heroic. It was 1:30 in the afternoon. There were a lot of people here.
Back in Edgar's Glendora neighborhood today, Thelma Osborne, who lives across the street, couldn't believe the news about her friend and neighbor.
Jeannie was a sweetie. She really was. And she looked out for other people on the block.
She says Edgar was a proud mother and grandmother. Osborne brought out pictures of their kids growing up together on the block.
It's a picture of her two boys and my dad making what he called his Popeye face.
Neighbors say Edgar liked to take her dog, Sashi, on walks.
That one little dog, she was so cute.
Edgar's family did not want to talk on camera, but sent a text saying, "We are heartbroken." You can see even more people stopping by to leave flowers. Detectives have cell phone and security cam video of what happened here. A knife was found. The suspect is set to be arraigned next week. No word on a motive.
One of the many signs that we are living in the end times is the epidemic of wickedness and violence that is sweeping the world today. Jesus tells us when society parallels the days of Noah, he will return, as we read in Matthew 24:37-39. But as the days of Noah were, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and given in marriage, until the day that Noah entered the ark, and did not know until the flood came and took them all away, so also will the coming of the Son of Man be. So what was going on in Noah's day that parallels our day? To find out the answer, we need to go back to the book of Genesis 6:5-13. Then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. So the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, creeping thing and birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. This is the genealogy of Noah. Noah was a just man, perfect in his generations. Noah walked with God, and Noah begot three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. The earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence. So God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And God said to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth. There is no doubt about the hour in which we live being the season for the return of the Lord Jesus Christ, as we link Matthew 24:12-37-39 with 2 Timothy 3:1-5. The Bible describes our day very clearly from these scriptures. The condition of wickedness and violence that caused the earth to be destroyed in Noah's day is the same condition our earth is in today. Luke 21:25, and there will be signs in the sun, in the moon, and in the stars, and on the earth distress of nations, with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring. One of the many signs we are living in the last days right before the return of Jesus Christ is nations will be in a state of perplexity or uncertainty over what to do in a difficult situation. This is exactly what is happening in our world today.
Bloodshed in Myanmar continues to escalate after more than 100 civilians were gunned down by security forces in the deadliest weekend since February's military coup. Local reports now say aerial attacks were launched against the Karen ethnic minority, driving thousands across the border with Thailand. The U.S. and other countries have condemned the killings as mass murder, and you can understand why. Lucy Kraft reports now from Tokyo.
As Myanmar's military celebrated its annual Armed Forces Day with a parade of hardware, it declared open season on the country's civilians. Even school children killed at home in a frenzy of state-sponsored violence as civil disobedience continued to protest the military's seizing of power. Social media circulated this drawing by 11-year-old Ai Miet Thu, buried with her, along with her toys. Activists say over 100 civilians were killed on Saturday alone, with thousands more detained or charged. Despite the carnage, strongman General Min Aung Hlaing was seen wining and dining at a gala dinner. Myanmar's brutal crackdown drew international condemnation, including from President Biden.
It's terrible. It's absolutely outrageous. And based on the reporting I've gotten, an awful lot of people have been killed. Totally unnecessary.
Human rights researcher Mauni Maung said the soldiers see themselves as victims.
And quite frankly, they're brainwashed. What's going on in their minds is that they're not doing anything wrong.
With both sides unlikely to back down, observers fear more bloodshed is inevitable.
Survivors from the siege in Palma arrive in the port city of Pemba just along the coast, but many others weren't as fortunate. Defense officials say dozens of others were killed trying to escape the fighting, and some of them were ambushed as they tried to leave Palma by road in a convoy. Since Wednesday, when an armed group launched its attack on Palma, communications have been down, and many families are still waiting to hear what's happened to their loved ones. This is the only footage that has emerged from inside the Amarula Hotel, where up to 200 people have reportedly taken refuge. Hundreds of others have attempted to flee the town, running into forests and nearby villages.
We don't know how we will get out of here, if we can get to the sea, or if we'll be rescued, or by whom. There are helicopters flying over the hotel. They're checking to see if we can reach the beach to get a boat out. But as you can hear, we don't know if it's possible. The situation is critical. We have no food, just water. We're in God's hands now.
Gun battles have been going on for days between the armed group that calls itself Al-Shabaab and government forces trying to take back control of the coastal town. More than 2,500 people have been killed and 500,000 forced to leave their homes during years of fighting in the province. Amnesty International blames several parties for war crimes. It has accused armed groups and a government-backed private South African military firm of being responsible for the deaths of hundreds of civilians. It also says government troops have made arrests without reason, tortured detainees, and carried out extrajudicial killings. Security forces say fighting is still ongoing, with army officials now trying to eliminate pockets of resistance. Humanitarian workers say it could be days before the actual number of dead is known, and they warn there will be even more internal displacement as people try to escape the fighting.
José Gregorio Alicarra is disheartened as he shows us a video of his home destroyed in clashes between the Venezuelan army and a Colombian rebel group.
It's really sad seeing how easy it is to lose everything you've built with great sacrifice.
He and his family fled a week ago from a town across the border as Venezuelan soldiers moved into their neighborhood and bombs fell from the sky. They left in such a hurry that he didn't have time to put shoes on. He is one of almost 5,000 people who have sought refuge in one of the 18 shelters set up in and around the border town of Arauquita in Colombia. They've come here after the Venezuelan army started an unprecedented operation against Colombian armed groups they had long tolerated in their territory. Many are accusing security forces of abuses and, in at least one case, of extrajudicial killings.
I'm afraid of going back to Venezuela because I don't know what they would do to us. The soldier killed our neighbor, her kids, and her husband. They say we're all guerrillas.
The influx of refugees, many young children, is overwhelming this town. On Sunday, the Colombian government set up a command post to manage the worsening humanitarian situation with the help of the United Nations Refugee Agency and other organizations.
We are living in a time Jesus refers to as the birth pains. God in His grace and mercy is warning the world of His impending judgment. The Bible refers to this judgment as the tribulation in which God will pour out His wrath on an unbelieving and unrepentant world. I have had many people ask the question, how do you know Jesus is returning? And why is today any different than any other time in history? Jesus gives His followers the answer to that question in Luke 21:28. Now when these things begin to happen, look up and lift up your heads, because your redemption draws near. Jesus told His followers that there would be a convergence of Bible prophecy right before His return. Notice Jesus said, when these things begin to happen. Jesus used the plural word things, meaning when you see multiple prophecies converging at the same time, that His return was at the doors, as we read in Matthew 24:33. So you also, when you see all these things, know that it is near, at the doors. There can be no denying all these things are beginning to take place. The next question is, how soon is the rapture of the church?
One day, Jesus is coming. You may be at church. You may be at work. You may be asleep. God grant that you will be ready when He makes His personal appearance. My God, what if His appearance occurs on a Sunday morning? My prophetic word to you this morning is get ready, get ready!
The signs of Jesus' soon return are so strong now and the evidence is so clear that any person willing to accept the truth can see that the end of the world as we know it is near. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But God demonstrates his own love toward us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. That if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. These are the ABCs of salvation. A. Admit that you're a sinner. B. Believe in your heart that Jesus Christ died for your sins, was buried, and God raised him from the dead. C. Call upon the name of the Lord, and you will be saved. Jesus paid the price for mankind's sin. He has provided a way to spend eternity with him and the Father. All you have to do is believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved. God has already done all the work. All you must do is receive in faith the salvation God offers. Fully trust in Jesus alone as the payment for your sins. Believe in him, and you will not perish. God is offering you salvation as a gift. All you have to do is accept it. Jesus is the only way of salvation. That being said, we must repent of our sins. While repentance is not a work that earns salvation, repentance unto salvation does result in works. It is impossible to truly and fully change your mind without that causing a change in action. In the Bible, repentance results in a change in behavior. Repentance, properly defined, is necessary for salvation. Biblical repentance is changing your mind about Jesus Christ and turning to God in faith for salvation. Turning from sin is not the definition of repentance, but it is one of the results of genuine, faith-based repentance towards the Lord Jesus Christ. Time is short. Call upon the name of Jesus today.